Greetings, everybody. Apologies for the long delay. This week, we are happy to present our first interview with author and musician Nathan Carson. It should be noted that Carl was still under the weather and didn't talk very much for fear of coughing through the interview. Also, apologies for the sound quality issues during the interview. I did what I could to fix them, but such is the nature of conducting interviews over Skype, it seems. Following that, there will be a segment of a reading that Nathan did at Powell's Books here in Portland. You can find the whole thing by searching Nathan Carson and Starr Creek with two R's on YouTube. That commotion that you hear at the end is indeed the sound of Nathan pouring Alpo dog kibble into a bowl and eating it. You are listening to Counter Esperanto Podcast, Tangents About Twin Peaks with Carl Eckler and Jubal Brousseau from the Pseudo Spaces Network. All right, we are here with Portland author and musician Nathan Carson. Nathan was raised in small town Oregon, and he is a founding member of the doom metal band Witch Mountain. He's worked as a music and film journalist and radio host and has pieces in myriad periodicals and websites such as Rumorg, SF Weekly, and Noisy. As a journalist, he has interviewed members of Devo, Black Sabbath, and Rush, and has most recently turned to writing weird fiction. He has stories in some excellent anthologies like Cthulhu Fatagan, The Madness of Dr. Caligari, and last November, Lazy Fascist Press released his first novella, Starr Creek, which has been described by author Brian Keene as Laird Barron meets Jack Ketchum in David Lynch's Twin Peaks. Carl and I have just finished reading it, and it's a crazy ride. Greetings to you, Nathan Carson.
Howdy, thanks for having me.
How are you faring in the snowpocalypse? It's finally starting to melt.
Well, finally today it became the slushpocalypse, which is what we've all been waiting for. Honestly, it's been tough on the city, but for me personally, as my own boss and someone who works from home, I can't say it's been all that bad. I did get stuck a couple of times on my way to and from my radio show last Wednesday, but otherwise I've pretty much just kept a fridge full of groceries and stayed put.
Yeah, as a student, I've mostly just been doing homework from home, and it's weird. We finally went to the grocery store yesterday, and it felt strange to be able to look further than 10 feet away.
Mm-hmm. I feel kind of selfishly relieved by the additional break, because 2016 was a really crazy and wonderful year for me, mm-hmm. and I was so busy that I essentially didn't take a weekend the entire year. And so having the holidays and then this ice and snowstorm immediately following is really letting me recharge my batteries and get ready for another big year.
I noticed in one of the interviews I read to sort of prepare that you said that there's this kind of dynamic where as a touring musician, you get basically full up on being in crowds and noisy areas and then you can kind of hole up and write. And then when you get stir crazy, it's time for another tour.
It's absolutely true. I mean, I'm not really a person who enjoys routine. You know, my last regular 40-hour-a-week job was in the 90s. Mm-hmm. So I like every day to be sort of a different challenge. And so bouncing back and forth between music and writing has been really wonderful. And likewise, you know, being at playing a doom metal show one day and going to the symphony the next, or sitting in my quiet house on the north side of Mount Tabor with my cat is also very peaceful. So I try to take it all in.
So you actually are an Oregon native, correct?
Well, I was born in New Hampshire. So technically I'm a Yankee from way back, but I was in Oregon in time to see Star Wars. So I feel pretty darn native.
If you saw Star Wars here, it counts as native, you ask me.
Thank you.
I didn't actually move to Portland until 94, just out of high school, but I did live in Portland as a child. And basically kind of like the time period, like the characters in your book, that early adolescence, mm-hmm. I lived in Montana, small town Montana. So small towns, I feel like I'm a small town native. And you mentioned before that you moved to the Starr Creek area at some point, or you lived there?
Yeah, I lived about a half a mile from the mouth of the road. And so I could see it from the front window of my house. And I would spend a lot of evenings walking out onto that road and watching the sunset and exploring the fields and forests of that area, because I always had this sense that it was a very haunted place. And also there were so many rumors of these strange inbred family feuds. And there were people that lived there without electricity and running water. And it was just a really odd place. And I know to a lot of city folk and East Coasters, it's a very exotic landscape. But to me, it was very normal because I lived on a goat farm in the woods until I was 18. I mean, I didn't have neighbors until I was 18. I didn't learn to ride a bike till I was about 8 because we were always on gravel and it was a hassle. So it's just how it was out there. And definitely my parents moved us to the West Coast in order to go backwards in time. The sense was that Mid Valley, Oregon in the late 70s was, you know, like a 20-year time warp.
You can definitely tell in the way that you wrote this book that you're not writing these characters as exotic. They definitely feel that they're grounded in the space.
I wanted them to be realistic people that would have realistic responses. I didn't want them to just simply be ninja action heroes at 14, but I also didn't want them to be so broken and terrified that they're incapable. You know, and they definitely run into some very bizarre scenarios. And I did not write the ending first. I actually created the situations and I created the characters and I tried to organically follow them so that they wouldn't be forced into any reactions that were dictated by the plot.
Tell us a little bit about your experience as a child. Did you encounter anything weird? Something that just really haunts you to this day?
Well, certainly. I mean, I've, living out in the woods, you encounter all kinds of things. And I wouldn't say there is a specific incident. I mean, I didn't have a UFO abduction experience or anything like that, but there's things you see out of the corner of your eye and the imagination runs wild, and there are people that live in the woods that want to be left alone. And so, you know, all of those things sort of became part of my background consciousness, and I think they all fed the story.
What Starr Creek really reminded me of was an area outside of Colville called Onion Creek, which had a lot of the same sort of people who might have running water, they might not. They probably didn't have a phone. There was a fairly high degree of fringe religious belief, and there was a very high degree of large-scale outdoor pot farming.
And this is during an era where you had to be extremely paranoid about that.
Oh, yes. Those were the hippies. There was also the motorcycle clubs that would be in the general area. They would be the ones who would be getting the really crappy trailers and filling them full of meth production facilities, which would cause fires and automatic weapons fire. And it was the reason there were more federal law enforcement officers in our town than cops.
Sure. The reality of Starr Creek Road is that Starr Creek, in theory, was a through road that went and connected to Hell's Canyon Road on the other side, as described in the book. And there truly was a family that lived out there that blocked off the road and put up no trespassing signs. And I and my friends, we were precocious teenagers, and we looked at a map and we saw that it was a through road. We went to the county and talked to them, and they said, oh yeah, it's legal. You're welcome to go through there if you want to, even though the county workers refused to do it because they'd been shot at so many times. At one point, electric poles were placed up, and when the workers came back the next day, they'd all been chainsawed down. So when my friends and I tried to drive out there, I know we got to the end of the road as far as these families were concerned that had blocked it off and had fallen trees over parts of the road so that they were impassable. And there was a light bulb hanging from a tree branch that was on in the daytime, and that felt very strange.
You said before that you took some existing urban legends and rumors and fears and whatnot and made it much worse. And that's kind of like what infused Starr Creek. What are some of the real events?
I definitely don't want to encourage anyone to go out there. And certainly the urban legends and myths that I base this on are very much from the past. I don't think any of those people live there anymore. As far as I know, a big meth bust in the 90s kind of cleared it all out. There were feuding families. There was an old woman that kind of ruled the end of the road with a shotgun. She did keep a mountain lion on a chain in the back of her pickup truck. You know, they were just some really strange folks. And I was always fascinated by them from a distance. I just thought, you know, what incredible fodder for a story. But of course, I'm writing fiction and I don't want to cause any trouble for anyone. And I don't want to make this into a place that tourists want to visit.
Right.
I would caution anyone from going out there because people live in these areas to be left alone.
Right.
But nevertheless, it is a rich landscape and a place that was very important to me. So, you know, Starr Creek is real.
Yeah. Speaking of people who like to be left alone, you mentioned in your book, there is the Nemi cult?
Yes.
Is that pure fabrication Or is that based on something that happened?
So what it is in the most loose sense based on is there were communes out there. And as far as I understand, one was begun by this guy who had a best-selling book on Volkswagen bus maintenance in the 60s. And he took his money and bought a big plot of land and lived out there. I don't really know beyond that where that went. The more specifics of the Nemi cult are, like many parts of this book, inspired by Fraser's Golden Bough.
I was about 10 years old in 1986, and we were living in Montana, and there was a cult in central Montana called Church Universal and Triumphant, and it was run by a woman named Elizabeth Clare Prophet. And I guess that was her actual name, so I guess it's maybe triggered something in her head.
Yeah.
But they were a doomsday cult. You know, every few years the world was coming to an end, and there would be people that would max out credit cards, buy a new truck, and like fill the truck with a bunch of stuff and bury it. And then when the apocalypse didn't happen, they'd be broke.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad actually worked for a time building bomb shelters for these people.
Wow.
Some of the friends that we had were people who kind of escaped the cult. You know, they kind of came to their senses, but still were a little off, you know. So it's definitely a subject that's near and dear to my heart.
Well, and certainly taking place in 1986 when Halley's Comet was passing over, you know, that was another sign of Armageddon for many.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a ton of end-of-the-world scenarios coming through in the mid-80s because the millennium was coming up and people were afraid that Halley's Comet was going to crash into the Earth. Nibiru was cycling through like it does every year. There was something kind of paranoid about the 80s, at least amongst the religious or the adult, whereas it seemed to me like all the adults were worried about the end of the world, so they weren't paying attention to the kids.
Oh, certainly. I mean, we had long leashes, and I don't regret that at all. But I think there was certainly a paranoia amongst the youth, particularly stemmed by that made-for-TV movie The Day After.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I certainly had nuclear nightmares or, you know, Red Dawn daydreams.
There was a show called The Americans that's set in the 80s, and it's about a couple that are Russian spies that are masquerading as American couple. And there is an episode where they watch that, and they spend about 15 minutes of it because this is all Cold War era stuff. And I don't remember that, but boy, that would have really scrambled my brain.
Yeah, I think I was 11 when that showed. And I mean, I was already certainly fascinated with horror movies. I was not sheltered, but the threat of nuclear annihilation seemed very real and possible at that time.
Yeah, it's like they're trying to recreate the duck and cover era, you know, of the 50s.
Mm-hmm.
Moving on, this is a great opportunity for us because not only because are you our first author on the podcast, but as a drummer in Witch Mountain, you're also an accomplished musician. And here on Counter Esperanto, we are turning our attention next to the confluence of the weird and music. And you said before that the realm of doom metal and weird fiction, especially the monster-ridden world of H.P. Lovecraft, are not too far apart. In what ways, if any, has your work with Witch Mountain informed your work as an author?
I knew this question was coming. I think the main way that it's affected my writing is that as a musician, I've been making collaborative art with three other people for the last 20 years. Mm-hmm. And especially as a drummer, being a non-melodic instrument and not the lead songwriter, none of which frustrates me. I'm very happy with the way our band works and what my input is as a booker and manager and the way we work together. But again, it's not really my creativity in the forefront in that scenario. And as a writer, it gives me a chance to have it be fully my voice, 100%. It's all me. You know, there's some minor touches from the editor, but in general, it's pretty unfiltered. Nathan Carson, this is what I'm thinking about or what I want to create. And so I don't think that the music informs the writing, but I think the situation of being in a band pushes me towards wanting to have a personal outlet. And the other thing is I get to work at my own pace. When I'm working with three other people, it has a lot of scheduling is involved and other people's creative methods. So that's why so much has happened in the last 3 years, I feel like, because I'm a pretty disciplined and motivated person, and I'm very good at networking, and I made a conscious decision when I turned 40 to not be a hobbyist artist about this. And another thing I could say about that is that Witch Mountain has shown me how to not be a hobbyist. You know, we're a serious band. We've recorded 4 albums. We've been played on NPR and, you know, reviewed on you know, every major press outlet you could think of, mm-hmm. and we've toured in like 27 countries. Now, granted, it's not a full-time job. It's not something where that's our entire lives, but as an artistic project, it's done well. It succeeded my initial expectations when we started doing it in 1997. So, you know, seeing so many of my friends and peers that struggle to, you know, get even out of their hometown or record an album that they can be proud of, Witch Mountain has shown me, yes, you know, you can take this stuff very seriously and it can go a long way. And so that was something I've certainly learned from the band.
Yeah, I'm not well versed in metal, but I really like what I'd heard. I found you on Spotify and checked it out. And the stuff I do like in that vein tends to be that kind of slower and menacing feeling, like, you know, doom metal and stoner metal. You know, obviously Sleep is probably the most famous band of that kind of the just carrying a drone, you know.
Sure. I mean, aside from Black Sabbath, Sleep's probably the only doom metal band that has ever been able to make a living and quit their jobs.
In that vein, there seems to be this idea of taking different modes of music, like playing music in sort of like ancient modes, the kind of chords that would often be found in sacred music or like really old Christian music, you know, from like the 1500s or something, and taking those scales and making them really frightening.
Yeah, certainly. That's something those guys are very fascinated in, and they're very interested in ancient religious texts and things like that. Witch Mountain is certainly more focused on the 60s and 70s and the present, I think. You know, we were certainly inspired by the Beatles, Jimi Hendrix, Pink Floyd, the Beach Boys, bands like that, and we tried to marry that with more modern metal approaches like Judas Priest and Candlemass, and then find our own voice and move forward with it. Like, even though our band is relatively traditional, I mean, it's blues-based, it's heavy, down-tuned metal, and it has very soulful but operatic melodic singing. But despite that, I don't think anyone really sounds exactly like us, and I'm proud of that.
Yeah, the vocals are incredible. I was, you know, kind of like taken aback, you know. It's like the, like you said, you know, there's examples of that kind of singing in older, you know, it's kind of like the classic music, but it's not something I hear much anymore.
No, I mean, most people find it easier to scream these days. And not that we don't have our screaming moments, but the woman who's screaming knows exactly how to do it. And it's very controlled. Kayla Dixon and Uta before her, like, we've just been really fortunate to work with really incredible vocalists. And I'm really proud to make music with people that are on that technical level. It's great.
Yeah, there's, you know, the singer Diamanda Galas comes to mind, mm-hmm. where, like, if you don't know any better, you think that, God, how is she not just tearing her throat out? Because it sounds like screaming, but it's very tightly controlled, and, you know, she's not tearing her throat out because she's trained, you know?
Yeah, she knows exactly what she's doing. She's incredible. I got to see her at the Portland Art Museum in 1995. It was a tour she did with John Paul Jones of Led Zeppelin, and it was really a treat to get to see them perform together.
Yeah, I think I saw her I think the next time through was when she was doing, I think it was Malediction and Prayer was the album. It was a piano-based stuff, and I got to meet her, and she's, you know, incredibly sweet. She's one of those people that's terrifying when she's performing, but the sweetest person when you
meet
her.
Sure. Well, she must have more catharsis than any of us.
Yeah. She actually said, I think she lived in San Diego, and she said that she had to figure out different places to practice because she's had the cops called on her because people thought that she was being murdered.
Absolutely. I mean, my parents are very open-minded. Like, my dad had seen The Stooges. My mom had seen Jimi Hendrix and Iron Butterfly. You know, there wasn't much I could do to offend them. But I definitely remember playing Diamanda Galas's Litany of Satan and Angry Women with Steak Knives in the living room. And my dad walks through and just looks at me and just shook his head. Like, yeah. What are you? I mean, it sounds like an entire barnyard of animals, you know, being throttled.
Yeah.
To me, it's music.
Yeah, on the album Shriek, I think it was, she has a song called Cunt, in which she screams the word cunt over and over again.
Sure.
That must not go over.
Although I think the Butthole Surfers did that best on their song Cunts on Locust Abortion Technician.
Yeah. Lately, I've been, as I was working on homework, I like to choose some, you know, wordless music, and I kind of got tired of listening to standard ambient, so I've been looking into the label Cryo Chamber, which has a really nice, that's the dark ambient stuff, which definitely has kind of a foot in both camps of ambient and metal. Some of it's kind of harsh, but the way that it's produced, it creates a calming effect. There's still some menace underneath it.
But, have you heard a German band called Boren and Der Club of Gore?
Oh, yeah, yeah. What's great about them is that you look at their album covers and you'd swear that it's metal, you know, but instead it's like the slowest It's like taking Angelo Badalamenti, like the Twin Peaks soundtrack, and slowing it to about a third of the speed.
I had the fortune of seeing them perform Black Earth at the Roadburn Festival some years ago, and I sat on the side of the stage while they performed the entire album in a nearly dark room, and it was so special.
As I was prepping to talk to you, I saw that you mentioned the album Cacophony by Rudimentary Peni. That's a favorite of mine. This is kind of getting back into the weird here, where it's a directly based on H.P. Lovecraft.
Yeah, I mean, I could speak a lot about that album. It was sort of my desert island album in high school. I bought it right when it came out because I was already a big fan of Death Church, and Cacophony just blew my mind wide open. I was already so passionately interested in H.P. Lovecraft that an entire art punk album all about him was perfectly up my alley, and it definitely responded even better under psychedelic influence. I think that it's much like Captain Beefheart's Trout Mask replica in many ways, and I actually bought a copy for ST Joshi a few years ago because he was unfamiliar with it.
Oh, wow.
I don't think it probably did much for him, but it meant something to me to be able to turn him on to something Lovecraft related that he was unfamiliar with. And I also had written a really serious pitch to the Continuum 33 and a third book series about that album, but of course it was just too obscure for their needs, I think.
Oh no, I'll buy it.
Oh, I mean, I don't think they realized what a cult following Peni has, and I think that book would have sold very well and been well regarded, and I was prepared to go guns blazing, and I thought that might be my first book, but, you know, the economy, books, whatever.
Yeah. Yeah, Nick Blanco is definitely a one-of-a-kind artist. I actually was introduced to him first by art that he's done for the band Coil. Some of their covers, like the really, really super busy, you look at it and it's madness. And that's something that's like, it's a perfect band to do an album based on Lovecraft because, you know, the stories of Lovecraft, that's a lot of them, but the stories that he writes where it's all from the point of view of someone who's lost their mind and they've just got their shit together just enough to write this piece of writing.
I think that's all of them.
Yeah, it's pretty much all of them, yeah. And I'm sure he takes a lot of that from Poe, you know, and things like that. But this idea that that someone has experienced something just terrible that they can't quite get the words together for, and that's Rudimentary Peni is kind of like the punk version of that.
Absolutely. I mean, I still think Death Church is the greatest punk album of all time, and it really helps that they were produced by John Loder. I mean, this guy was an exceptional engineer who in later years was the go-to guy when Steve Albini needed someone to master the early Shellac albums. So if you figure, you know, how fortunate is it that this broke British punk band that almost never performed live, recorded all their albums with the guy who Steve Albini would go to for help.
Right. I wanted to say something about Starr Creek without giving too much away. I like how you approach the sort of the central horror of the story, which is this thing that almost that can't really be seen when directly looked at, but gives you the sense of its shape. It's the same kind of thing that Lovecraft will do, which will give you two or three details that'll let you fill in the rest. In a way, it reminds me of the Dunwich horror. You get this very clear image in your head, even if everybody's, you know, thought of this creature is different. You know?
Or Ambrose Bierce's The Damned Thing.
Yeah.
It's best to allude to a horror and let the imagination do the rest, because everyone's going to imagine something different. And I think if you over-describe it, then you are making it too concrete, and some of that unknown quality is going to dissipate. And we all know Lovecraft's thoughts on the fear of the unknown. So I remember I had my advanced placement English teacher in high school. I mentioned my fascination with Lovecraft, and she was actually complimentary of him, but she said, "Oh, yes, Poe takes you to the mouth of the tomb, but Lovecraft takes you inside and describes it in detail." And I kind of had to contradict her and say, "I don't know. He uses a lot of words like unspeakable and unnameable and indescribable, so I wouldn't necessarily say that he clearly indicates what any of these creatures are supposed to look like." I think the imagination has to fill in those gaps for it to be effective.
Yeah, and that's probably why some people kind of miscategorize H.P. Lovecraft as sort of a schlock writer or a bad writer, because, you know, he's not using descriptive terms. But to me, it's the fumbling of the mind to be able to even get a handle on what it's seeing.
Lovecraft uses a lot of descriptive words, but they're frequently describing what it's not. They were not entirely fungi or maggots or decapitated human corpses or winged batrachian things, but a combination of all of these and something else.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
My other favorite author is Gene Wolfe, and in his book of the New Sun, you know, in this 4-volume epic science fantasy, he doesn't invent any words. And so anytime he's at a loss for a word for a description, he would use an archaic term. So he's calling something a Baluch theorem for lack of any future world term. He didn't want to use fantasy gobbledygook like a lot of authors do, especially in fantasy. So I think that's an interesting approach as well.
Is there anybody else that was either a contemporary or maybe before Lovecraft, maybe one of his inspirations that you've latched onto?
I've definitely spent a lot of time with Algernon Blackwood's The Willows lately. I really like that story a lot. Of course, I've read pretty widely throughout all of Lovecraft's influences and the Lovecraft circle. I got interested in Lovecraft at age 10, and so that's given me 33 years to explore Robert W. Chambers and Clark Ashton Smith and Robert E. Howard and Robert Bloch and all these other people. But, you know, nobody really compares to the master.
No. Yeah, when they finally gave him
The Library of America Tales.
I loved seeing that.
Yeah. We've talked about if there is a weird writer that is in the same wheelhouse as Twin Peaks, I would say it's somebody like Blackwood.
I love Ambrose Bierce as well, of course.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Ambrose Bierce, I can't remember which one it was. It might have been The Damned Thing, where he has little subheadings where it says, a man, though naked, may be in rags, mm-hmm. is one of the things. And that's such an evocative phrase because it's talking about a corpse that's been shredded by an unseen monster.
His Devil's Dictionary is full of little quips like that.
Yeah, yeah. It's sort of like the Mark Twain of weird fiction, you know. It's
brilliant guy. And his demise is so mysterious, too. I mean, he walked into Mexico and was never seen again.
One interesting thing with Blackwood is this thing where it's not necessarily that there is some cosmic thing that's coming from space or from other dimensions. Well, it is, but it's rooted in the natural world. Mm-hmm. Our minds aren't able to really get a handle on it. It's the idea that if you look at all of the actual frequencies of light and sound there are, we're basically deaf and blind.
Well, I agree with that. There are such wide spectrums that we can't even recognize. And anytime I see a depiction of alien life, it seems to me that of course there's life out there, but it's not going to be anything like anyone has ever predicted or imagined. Like, whatever it is, we have not even considered it yet, I think, most likely. And so, of course, for the alien creatures in my book, I didn't want them to be easily described or seen or understood. And so I tried to really keep them abstract in that way, because I think it's more unsettling if you can't really wrap your mind or your senses around it.
Yeah, I think you've succeeded admirably.
Oh, thank you.
One of the great things about Starr Creek is that it definitely has some frightening scenes, but it's also a lot of fun. It's this idea of seeing biker gangs and a weird cult and kids of different ages sort of all thrown into one stew. They're all having a completely different take on what they're seeing.
Yeah, I mean, I never set out to write a horror novel with a capital H. Of course, there were going to be horror elements, and I did want to make it extreme at points because I think we're in an era where everyone's so jaded, it's hard to really, you know, get a response from people anymore. So, you know, luckily there were a scene or two that I think are pretty unnerving. I know I got some really complimentary feedback from Brian Keene saying that I disturbed him and that he's hard to disturb, and so that was flattering. You know, mostly that was the story that I wanted to tell, and I wasn't thinking about genre or even necessarily vibe or effect. What I really wanted was to make something that was energetic and entertaining and satisfying. You know, even if the ending maybe takes a few days to become satisfying, I know a lot of people feel a little frustrated by the end of it, but they usually come around.
That does happen sometimes with weird novels, like longer form. And what by longer form, I mean more than 20 or 30 pages. Mm-hmm. This is a novella, and I think we talked in a past episode about how weird fiction works best when it's short. And there are weird novels, but they tend to be short novels. A good one recently that comes to mind is The Fisherman. Mm-hmm. I'm drawing a blank on his name, on the writer's
That's
name.
Langan, John Langan.
Yeah, John Langan, yeah. He's definitely up there with Barron and Thomas Ligotti in my mind as far as like people that are just untouchable right now, you know.
That's great. He seems to be doing really well with it. I love seeing all the attention for that book. I'm really happy to see that.
For our listeners, that is The Fisherman, just as it sounds. It's a quick read, but it is super dense for only a couple hundred pages. But that's one of those where it puzzled me as I was reading it. It took a while to actually read it because I tend to read several books at once. It's so hard to kind of get your your head around what's happening. It's like the picture that he's painting is right out of Hieronymus Bosch. And it takes a little while for it to sink in, you know. But sometimes these like longer form weird fiction works that way. But it's, I think your novel is that way. I only finished it this morning, but I think that's one of those that creeping dread will continue to set in for a while.
I hope so. The only criticisms I've really had on the book so far are people that were saying it was too short and that they wished that there was more. But that was absolutely my intent, was I didn't want anyone to have a chance to get bored. I wanted to make something that was hard to put down and that really worked like a funnel where, you know, there's some introduction and then it just starts ramping up and ramping up and ramping up. And, you know, my structure for that book is kind of based on that scene in Mad Max where Toe Cutter like drives into that semi and you see the biker and then the truck and then the biker and then the truck and then his eyes open wide and then it's over.
Yeah.
For me, the ending did not disappoint at all. I think the funnel is an apt way of describing it. What it reminded me of was actually Frank Herbert's Dune. Mm-hmm. And Frank Herbert said that he structured Dune like an episode of Lovemaking where it starts off slow and things start to form. The various plot lines start to congeal and swirl around each other, and the end happens like an orgasm. There's lots of activity, and then your mind goes completely blank.
I'm glad you worked the word congeal into that.
Yeah, I was working on that for a while.
Yeah, usually the congealing happens later.
Well, you know.
But yeah. I love Dune. I'm a huge fan of that book and the film, for that matter. I got to see that in the theater with my parents as a kid, and that was my introduction to that world, and it still works for me.
He gets a bad rap for it, and he didn't care for it himself, but I think part of it is that was the reason that David Lynch insisted upon Final Cut. The mm-hmm. so-called director's cut, I don't even know if it's official, but they did add about 15 or 20 minutes, and it helps.
There's a long version, but it's still not signed off on by him. He doesn't want his name on it, and I mean, who knows? Maybe once this new Twin Peaks is done and out, maybe someone could convince him to go through and make a director's cut of Dune. I think many of us would love to see that. But at the same time, I'm thoroughly satisfied with his original, and I don't even need the long version for that matter.
A lot of people had an issue, you know, that watch it have an issue with the whispering voiceovers, but I really liked that, actually, especially once I was more familiar with the book. I can see why he made that decision, because there is so much interiority in the book.
Well, he's trying to cover 1.5 novels in a 2-hour film as well, which That's I think true. Was very ambitious. But it's also the only chance he's ever had to spend $40 million on a movie. And he made a very beautiful movie. It was just abstract for that audience. And potentially readers of the book are going to be disturbed by the changes that he made. But to me, what's important is that wood and brass future. It's just so gorgeous.
Have you seen the sci-fi version of Dune and Children of Dune?
Yes. And it's bland.
It's
bland.
It's god-awful. It feels like walking into a modernist, ultra-clean, absolutely nothing space.
Yeah.
A feeling of, this is new and vital, and that is just not what Dune is at all. It's set in the year 10,191 for fuck's sake.
Yeah, it needs that decadence.
Yeah.
You know, which also Gene Wolfe's Book of the New Sun has. Mm. You know, it's so steeped in decadence. I don't know if you guys have read that, but
I've read the first one, and
better than Dune, better than Tolkien. I will call it out right now. Gene Wolfe's Book of the New Sun, he's the James Joyce of science fantasy, and that future world he imagines is bar none. It's the best fantasy anything I've ever read, and especially his language. I mean, he's such a literary author. He's going to die in the next few years, and then he'll be taught on every college campus forever.
It's funny how that works.
Yeah.
I definitely agree with you there, except that hopefully we'll be able to freeze him in carbonite first so that we can revive
him. That would be great.
Once the moon turns green. But he got the idea of that Rococo bricolage, that stuff on top of stuff on top of stuff. That gives you the feeling of the weight of society that pushes people into the roles that they can't escape from. It was so necessary for the Dune movie, and nobody else got that. And it seems like people still don't understand what he was doing there.
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure there are some people that just on a really surface level think that it's steampunk in some way, which to me is an insult.
I think I saw you mention somewhere that you are taking kind of this world and going about 50 years into the future with your next book?
Yeah, about 76 years into the future. Wow. How, you know, connected the two stories will be remains to be seen. But the fact is, I had already intended to do a, you know, sort of near to mid future secessionist Northwest science fiction novel anyway. That was my original intent for a first book, and I've been making notes on it for years. But when Lazy Fascist invited me to do a novella, I knew that I needed to do something that was closer to home and that I could knock out in a shorter amount of time. And so I decided to do something set in the 80s and in, you know, my homeland area. But now I'm kind of going back to plan A to work on this next book. And I, since they're both in the Northwest, I see no reason not to have them be the same world.
Yeah, you can at least extrapolate knowing the culture and everything. Like you said before, the if it was set in Thailand in 1914, you'd have to do a lot more research.
Absolutely. I mean, I wanted to focus on the characters and the plot. I didn't want to be sitting there thinking about the setting as well. I needed a setting that I was intimately familiar with, and Starr Creek was ground zero for that.
Are you also working on short stories still?
Yes, I've got ideas for some new shorts that I'll be writing soon. And I'm also working on a 2-issue comic book that I'm really excited about that should be out around Halloween.
Since this is also a Twin Peaks podcast, we'll talk a little bit about that. When did you discover Twin Peaks?
My mom was a fan of the TV show when I was in high school, and I didn't watch from the first episode, so I kind of missed the boat because it was before the days when it was available on home video, and it's not the sort of show you can kind of just jump into in the middle.
Right.
So my mom had actually gotten me to watch Blue Velvet with her when I was about 12. I think it was around the same time that my dad got me to watch Clockwork Orange. So I was getting a lot of good influence from my parents in these, you know, with extreme cinematography. Let's see, when did I finally watch Twin Peaks? Probably would have been around 99, I think. I probably finally saw them all on VHS, and I loved them. I mean, by that time I knew pretty much all of Lynch's other works, but I really came from the films first, like Eraserhead and Blue Velvet and Wild at Heart, which is maybe my favorite film of all time. And I guess Dune probably was the first one that I saw in the theater, but I had no idea who he was at that time, and his name wasn't on it.
Dune was the first thing I ever saw, and it scared the crap out of me. When I was a kid, I saw it. I think it was on cable or something, you know, and as soon as you see the Harkonnens, it's just like, oh God, get me out of here, you know.
Yeah, they're disgusting, and that's so effective. It's wonderful. I mean, Jabba the Hutt's got nothing on Baron Harkonnen.
It's true. I think we saw Twin Peaks around the mid-90s and also on VHS, and there's something about watching it in rapid succession, because that was the thing where it's like I knew it when it was on, but you try to start watching around the sixth episode and you're just completely lost.
Yeah, and when it was on was a point where I was becoming a lot less interested in television. If I'd only known that that was the best possible television and that I had free access to it, I would have watched it every week. But I just didn't really quite know what it was at the time. And so I came to it later, but I loved it. And having said that, I've probably only seen the whole series maybe twice in its entirety. I haven't obsessed on it. I've got the Laura Palmer's diary on my shelf, but I can't say that I've really read it cover to cover. I did make it to the Twin Peaks Festival last year because Julie Cruz was performing.
Oh, wow. How was the festival? I've never actually been, which is sort of embarrassing to admit because I'm only 4 hours away. But
you know, I was there really briefly, but it was pretty cool, and it was nice to step into the diner and, you know, be sitting like right behind, oh, what's her name? Who wears the eye patch? Nadine, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, she was sitting right in front of me in the theater, and I'm just kind of surreal.
What are your thoughts on the upcoming revival?
I mean, it seems like he's going to do it right and true to himself, and that he made every demand to not compromise his vision. I think we all know enough about David Lynch to know that he's going to frustrate us on some level or another. Like, it can never be exactly what we expect, but at least it's the correct team of people doing it. I mean, like, the new Star Wars really failed for me, but Mad Max worked. And I think Fury Road worked because it's still the same auteur and his right. vision is intact and he was allowed to make the movie he wanted to make. Whereas Star Wars, it's a new team of people kind of working by committee and using focus groups and re-editing shit after it's done in order to make sure that it satisfies the most stupid people. I think that Twin Peaks is not made to satisfy, and even the greatest fans will likely be frustrated in certain ways, but you have to respect David Lynch because he doesn't compromise. And so I think it's going to be great. I look forward to it, but I also, you know, it's hard to go back. So I sort of reserve judgment until I've seen it.
Yeah.
It's going to have elements of frustration in it. And I say, thank God for that, because that's going to give me another 25 years of stuff to poke at. So
I mean, even Fire Walk With Me at the time, people were like, this isn't like the show, and they didn't know what to do with it. And of course, it stands well on its own now. And in retrospect, you know, I wouldn't change a thing about it, but it's different than the show. And I think the new show is going to be different than that. And people need to be ready for that, because if they think it's just going to slip snugly back into where they were at, I mean, even the second season is not the same as the first. So
right. Yeah, and that's the thing, is like the second season was a little bit more committee. They kind of lost their thread, and you can tell that around the middle of the season they were really struggling to get it back on track, and it was too late by the time they did, you know. But
I feel that happened with Carnival as well. Like, I thought that was such an excellent first season, and it was agonizingly paced, and then they got canceled, and then they got public outcry and they came back, but that second season seemed like it was two or three seasons worth of episodes rushed in order to get to a certain point. And there were certainly high points in that second season, but it was a very different show.
I think one of the most hopeful things about Twin Peaks is that they've been given absolute freedom to create what they want without censorship. David Lynch does have a tendency to push things a little hard when he's completely without reins. I'm thinking of Inland Empire, which I enjoyed, but he doesn't need much of a budget when he was shooting on digital that way, and it was kind of an insane venture, but we still have Mark Frost to kind of rein him in a little.
It's going to be 18 hours of Lynch Frost created something, and I don't see that as being bad. It might not be anything like what we expect, but it'll be interesting.
Nathan, what you got coming up in the next few months? Any music releases, or are you going to be doing any readings anywhere?
I'm wrapping up this comic script because the artist is going to need a lot of time to get that together. Then I definitely have this short story that I'm ready to dive into as soon as possible. I want to get to work on the next book, and Witch Mountain is working on writing a new album right now that we want to have out by the fall. So a lot of creative projects on the stove. Just sort of finishing out the promotional cycle for Starr Creek before I really get serious and dive into these other things, because I'm very good at multitasking by nature, but writing fiction takes a lot of my attention and a lot of my spirit has to go into it, and I need as few distractions as possible, which is why my best writing nights tend to be like Friday and Saturday night when all my friends are doing other things and my email drops to a trickle, and I can just kind of turn everything off. Like, I don't write to music. I try to write in silence, or potentially one of those like 10-hour rainstorm tracks off YouTube or something.
Oh, yeah. I used to do homework or writing to, there's like a 24 hours of the sound of the engine from Star Trek The Next Generation.
Sure. That's a nice one.
It's just that you have that going on a nice stereo with good bass, and it just kind of underlies everything. And it's not even really, you know, again, it's not music. So it just kind of creates this sort of womb-like feeling.
There's a Blade Runner environmental disc you can get as well. It puts you in the streets and vibe of Blade Runner. If you look up the Esper Retirement Edition of Blade Runner, it's like a 6-disc bootleg that's a lot of music that you can't get from the official releases.
I think it's Mondo Recordings. I'm drawing a blank on the label, but they're the ones that put out the Twin Peaks soundtrack. They did the series last year, and this year they're doing Fire Walk With Me, and they just do a beautiful remastering job on it. But it is possible to go out and get, I think it's free or it's really cheap. There's 217 tracks of Angelo Badalamenti and David Lynch music from the series, because they did multiple versions of the themes they put under different scenes in it, so that it's all this different instrumentation of the same pieces. But that's something that's worth checking out. If you
nice.
Like that.
I've got a 10-inch of the Castlevania 2 music on the way from Mondo right now. Should be arriving tomorrow or the next day. I'm looking forward to that.
I love that old stuff. I used to actually, this is almost too nerdy to admit, but I used to tape music off of Nintendo games.
Mm-hmm. The Metroid music is incredible.
Yeah. Yeah, once the Super Nintendo came around and they had a few more voices and things started sounding more rich, it's like, wow, this sounds almost like a symphony. You know,
Yeah. Yeah, I ordered a CD from Japan in the late 90s that's Metroid and Super Metroid, and as well as a few orchestral arranged pieces that were done for some performance or show in Japan. I don't know. I can't read the liner notes because it's all in Japanese. But, man, I've spent a lot of time listening to that music and my Robotech soundtrack as well.
So how could people find you out there in cyber world or whatever we want to call it?
Well, I'm pretty easy to find. I'm a pretty public person, but I have a new website called nathancarson.rocks, which I just thought was the most hilarious but easily memorable URL that I could buy. I was like, wow, that's available? No one will forget that. Witch Mountain is on Bandcamp. You know, if you search for Witch Mountain, you're either going to find the Disney movie or my band, so that's pretty easy. There's a new single that's available on 12-inch from us, or you can listen to it on the NPR link for where they posted it.
Great. Well, thank you so much for being on. This has been, you're easy to talk to, and it's been a great first interview for a podcast.
Well, I really appreciate you guys having me. Thanks a lot.
Yes, yeah, thank you very, very much.
Thank you for listening to the Counter Esperanto podcast on the Pseudospaces Network. Please direct all email correspondence to counteresperanto at pseudospaces. That's pseudospace.es. Thank you.
Chapter 2, Wednesday, June 18th, 1986. Willie's fat fist connected in an uppercut to the gut. A gallon of undigested dry dog food sprayed out of Puppy's mouth on a wave of bile and beer froth. Puppy, hands on knees, hurtled a few more times on the scored wood floor. Willie waddled in a circle around him, grinning like a fat cat that forgot its mange long enough to gloat over a wounded baby bird. His greasy black hair shone in the neon light and scintillating fiber optic waterfall wall art. Before Puppy could wipe his lips of dreck, a biker boot kicked his ass out the saloon door and into the hungry blue night. Puppy had driven into the little town of Monroe a few hours prior, truck coasting on fumes, meter on E. He was half-starved, too. He hadn't eaten in 2 days. It didn't have to be that way, but he couldn't take any chances. He'd lost last time and didn't sit well with humiliation. Those lowlifes had treated him like spoor tweezed out of boot treads with a twig. Puppy eased his liver-spotted pickup into the last parking spot behind the squat, flat-topped cottage. The emergency brake ratcheted up with a dying squeal. The sign above the wood-bordered tavern door read the Golden Bough. Everyone in town called it the Boog, though, since they found it easier to abbreviate Booger than do something abstract like assign a color to a formal gesture. On the flickering backlit marquee, black letters read, Third Wed, Dog Food Eating Contest, 9 p.m., win $50. The prize was a lot more than what hadn't slipped through the holes in the pockets of Puppy's pants. The Boog was warm inside, but too crowded. Puppy knew how it felt to sleep all in a pile on a cold winter night, fighting damp drafts with the heat of shivering bodies. But awake on the verge of summer, this was overwhelming. Nowhere to go without brushing some biker's belly, some barmaid's behind, or dropping a drink in a feisty farmer's lap. Puppy wound his way to the sign-up sheet, scratched his name in pencil stub. He poured himself a mug of Oli and settled into a corner to wait his turn. The jukebox throbbed with a Harryhausen beast battle of charging guitar, tussling with riding saxophone. Both bled each other to death over the march of drums and the crackle and burl of blown speaker blight. Puppy didn't let his beer grow warm, but neither did he fill the gnawing hollow in his bought belly. A clock on the wall in the shape of Mount St. Helens before it blew read 9:42. The bartender had one long arm and one short one, just like the clock. He used them to upend and pour a bag of Alpo into a police lineup of colored plastic bowls. One by one, bikers of all sizes, some vested, some bare-chested, took their turn snuffling face first in the dog bowls. They chugged pitchers of beer to choke down the muck. Some dumped the suds in first and ate it like cereal. Others swallowed handfuls like pills. One guy produced a bottle of homemade barbecue sauce from a shoulder holster. When someone called foul and confiscated it, he lurked away, grumbling in surrender. Another guy clamped a clothespin on his bulging, hair-infested nose. Puppy just watched and waited and sipped. He felt his hunger burble and grow. A vast man named Willie strode up to the bar. Puppy remembered him. Willie was the winner this time last month. The room got quiet. Someone pulled the plug on the jukebox and angled a lampshade like a spotlight. Embroidered on the back of Willie's denim jacket was a harp with angel wings. On the front of his shirt was a black and white cartoon mouse steering an old wooden ship wheel with his squiggly arms. The shirt didn't stretch far enough to cover Willie's navel. His exposed belly hung well past his fly. The great man picked up a full bowl with both hands. He held it aloft like a crown. After he'd surveyed the crowd, he dipped in a finger, licked it, and smiled. Then he slammed the bowl on the bar and took a stool over which his fat ass sagged. He buried his face in one, then a second dog dish until each shone clean. Willie licked his lips when all three bowls clattered empty. Then he reached over the bar and dug into the bag to shove a final fistful into his mouth. When he chewed and swallowed, applause erupted around the room. Someone plugged the jukebox back in and blew a quarter on Eat It, which was still a big hit in Monroe. Can't just talk the talk. I hate this part. The bartender reached into the register and started counting out 10 $5 bills.